So this brings us to the issue that we may interpret anime as a character database. It's not necessarily a genre, but it's more like the character database through which we can create secondary creations, programs as a local narrative of this grand narrative database. So here we can see some transformations from story-oriented narrative to character-oriented anime programs. And this is one of the reasons in recent, you know, anime culture, people talk about moe rather than characters. Traditionally, you know, we usually talk about programs, Gundam, or, you know, characters like, you know, Ram. But we rather talk about moe, so character traits, characteristics, which is shared in anime culture. It's originally, you know, literally means to sprout or to bud, but it's more like character fetish. And a character, every anything can be basically character fetish, like hairstyle, you know. For example, twin tail is a two pigtail, that is, you know, if you some character has a twin pigtail, that's, you know, moe, because, you know, someone has, you know, attachment to the twin pigtails, or, you know, personality, or a way of talking, specific, interesting way of talking in Japanese. And fashion, or even occupation, like, you know, nurse or maid. Maid is a major, you know, recently really popular field or situation. Or even, you know, your relationships, right? Sister, sister can be a good, you know, attractive, moe kind of, you know, characteristic. And usually you may remember that I presented that in traditional Hollywood classical narrative system, character should be defined in the narration, because narration, narrative should be goal-oriented, and the goal should define each character. So character should not be independent from the narrative system. But it seems like in those character representations, they are just presenting characters regardless of those characters' function in the narrative. So this is almost like a caricature. This is a theory proposed by Azuma Hiroki, but this is, you know, some of the really exaggerated, you know, cat's ears, bunny ears, and a combination of ears and strange ornamentation, like makes, you know, really caricaturalized characters. And it's obviously not mimicking our reality. It's just mimicking. If those characters do mimic something, it's just mimicking anime culture or anime database in general. So again, you know, creation is becoming not representation of reality, it's more like, you know, representation of representation of representation. Everything becomes copies of copies of copies, and we can't trace it back to the reality. Gradually, more and more removed from our reality, and create this grand narrative called Japanese animation, or anime as a, you know, almost like a grand narrative. And this is, I got, you know, New York Times magazine. It was one of the, you know, special articles about love in 2D. This is really famous guy, just carrying this, you know, human-sized anime character pillow everywhere. And, you know, just, he's claiming that, you know, this is my girlfriend. Obviously, again, you can see this is almost, he is almost, you know, performing that, you know, really ugly kind of consumption, exaggerating, or almost excess about, you know, character attachment. So he is pretty much, although, you know, the article is a little bit taking his actions too seriously. But I think he completely aware about, you know, what he's doing, and presenting this, you know, really distorted character fetish in a really interesting way. All right, let's, in order to summarize my argument, let's, I want to present David Bordwell's classical Hollywood style system based on Hollywood movies starting 1970s to 1960s, he presented many assumptions about so-called classical Hollywood system. And it basically dominates film studies in general. So all the theories almost, you know, established, now it's becoming commonplace in film studies established by this guy. So. And he talks about, you know, three areas, but I particularly focus on narrative logic. And in terms of narrative logic, by the way, those two are, you know, my future project. Why I talked about, you know, aesthetics in some other places, so I don't talk about those issues this time. But basically, a system of narrative logic. Usually there should be two storylines and it's important to always have the heterosexual relationships as the secondary line. First line is mostly about, you know, saving the world or, you know, fighting with the aliens, or could be, you know, something everyday, like, you know, getting a good score at college life, or, you know, becoming a really popular guy among friends, or it depends. But always there should the first line should be supported by the second line. And the second line is always about heterosexual, you know, relationships. So what it means to be happy ending in Hollywood films is basically correspondence, coincidence of the two storyline towards the end of the film. So for the first line, it may be difficult to, you know, find a good closure of the, you know, really complicated issue about, you know, how to deal with, you know, healthcare issues, or, you know, America, how to save the United States. Should we save all the, you know, races, or just, you know, white people, and, you know, throw away, you know, marginalized people? It's really complicated issues. But always the first line should be supplemented by the second line. And because of the perfect and happy merger of two heterosexual, you know, persons towards the end of the film, you get the feeling that, you know, the first line is always, you know, completely fine. So that's basically the magic of the Hollywood system. And based on this structure, in fact, Linda Williams present, you know, really interesting ways that so-called excessive junk manipulate those expectations and narrative logic. And basically, the structure of the fantasy or fantasy movies, excessive movie junk, are prolongation of desire, and the. Films basically manipulate how to manage that prolongation of the desire. And you, this is Franco Moretti. Franco Moretti talked about melodrama in European cinema, European cinema and European novels, and basically talked about melodrama is about manipulation of the spatial, temporal continuity, in which, you know, the main protagonist or characters don't know about his or her real desires up to the very last moment. Yeah. Although, you know, the audience have a better knowledge about, you know, something those characters don't know. But toward the end of the novel, melodramatic stories, you will realize that characters' realization of what we already know is too late. And that create your, you know, impotence and powerlessness about the character. And that will create a melodramatic moment, according to Franco Moretti.